Okay, so disclosure of finances. Okay, so these were the learning objectives we will have, as Anse has already said earlier. So types of headaches. Usually when we talk of headaches, we talk of either primary headaches or secondary headaches. And usually primary headaches are benign. They are usually recurrent. And usually there is no organic cause that you can identify. And it is a disorder in itself. Now, part of your job as a doctor or a neurologist is that you always have to identify secondary headaches because these are the ones with underlying organic disease. Now, what are the pain-sensitive structures in the head? No, you have your scalp, you have your middle meningeal artery, you have your dural sinuses, your fac cerebri, and your proximal segments of the large PL arteries. Now, what structures are involved in your primary headaches? This would enlarge intracranial vessels, your dura mater, the peripheral terminals of the trigeminal nerve, of course, your caudal portion of the trigeminal nucleus and your trigeminal cervical complex, and your pain modulatory systems. Now, in terms of prevalence, the most common type would be your tension type headache, followed by headache from systemic infection. So as neurologists, especially in the hospital, we get referred a lot of patients due to headache who have some form of systemic infection. Migraine would come a third to about 16%. So you can see here, in this particular study, brain tumors actually make up a very small percentage as a cause of headache. So more common would be your migraine with or without aura, your tension type and your cluster. And among your other primary headache disorders that are less common would include your paroxysmal hemicrania, your idiopathic stabbing headache, your cold stimulus headache, your benign cough headache, benign accessional, and those associated with sexual activity. Here are examples of your secondary headache disorders. You have headaches associated with vascular disorders, such as your subarachnoid hemorrhage, your unruptured vascular malformations, arteritis, venous thrombosis, arterial hypertension. And you have those headaches associated with non-vascular intracranial disorders, such as your BIH, or your benign intracranial hypertension, your intracranial infection, and your low CSF pressures. As an example, would be post-lumbar tap. And those that are associated with non-cephalic infection, such as your systemic viral infections or bacterial infection. You can also have headaches associated with head trauma, your post-traumatic headache, can be associated with substance abuse or withdrawal, and those associated with metabolic disorders, such as hypoxia, hypercapnia, or mixed hypoxia, hypercapnia, and those newly undergoing dialysis. You can also have headache or facial pain associated with disorders of the cranium, the neck, the eyes, the ears, the nose, the sinuses, teeth, mouth, or other facial or cranial structures. And you can have your cranial neuralgias or nerve trunk pain and the afferentation pain. Now, in terms of prevalence, and this I do see in my own clinic, is that a large proportion would actually be patients that would consult to the clinic would be due to migraine and headache. This is from the Inquirer a few years ago. It says that 17.6% of women and 5.7% of men in the Philippines have migraine. And usually migraine can occur during childhood, but most often begin during adolescence and certainly will appear before age 40. Migraine does have a familial basis because you would note that it would run in families, although studies are still ongoing for the specific genetic link. Although one can say it's always an interaction between the environment and the genes. During childhood, migraine prevalence, the boys would equal the girls. During puberty, there's increase in prevalence in women, and this would continue during midlife, and this would be where you have your highest prevalence of migraine. So here, you see the prevalence and impact of migraine. So in females, it goes up during your productive years and then goes down during the later years. And males, they do go up, but not as high as females in terms of prevalence. Now, migraine may be benign, but it does have a lot of impact with regards to school, household chores, or productivity. So it's important we be able to treat our patients with migraine. In migraine, again, this is another slide which would show you the processing of vascular head pain, important in the treatment of migraine. So you have your cranial vessels innervated by your ophthalmic branch of the trigeminal nerve, your dura mater also innervated by your ophthalmic branch of the trigeminal nerve. Then you have your first, second, and third order neurons, and you have your modulatory neurons in the midbrain and hypothalamus, and finally in the cortex. Before, migraine was explained as a vascular type headache. They initially said that migraines were due to vasodilatation, in which blood vessels are dilated and it then causes pain. Then there's a neurological theory that migraines are due to a neurovascular disorder. So there is a neuronal dysfunction in which neuropeptides are released from the trigeminal system, causing the dilation of meningeal vessels. No? So it starts from the brain. One type of migraine you're familiar with, which is an ion channelopathy, actually shows genetic linkage, you know, to chromosome 19. So one would presuppose that other types of migraine, especially since we would notice that it runs in families, would also have a genetic basis. So migraine mechanism should involve either abnormal activation of your trigeminal cervical afferents or abnormal modulation of trigeminal cervical neurons. So here we have your another diagram showing your migraine mechanism. So you can have some risk factors here or modulating factors, the environment, and this might cause or trigger a disturbance of cortical or brainstem excitability. Now this would can proceed to have your cortical waves or what we call your cortical spreading depression. This is in charge of your aura. This would also cause an increase in your blood-brain permeability. It might cause pain. And this would also lead to brainstem activation, your trigeminal nucleus caudalis, which would lead to sensory sensitivity, your photophobia, cutaneous agludynia, nausea, vertigo. So this is actually just normal light, normal sound that normally will not cause pain, but patients with migraine, they're especially sensitive to these sensations. You can then have activation of your pain receptors, and because of this and brainstem activation, this would lead to the pain that would be felt by patients with migraine. One thing about migraine is that migraine actually starts hours before the actual pain. In fact, patients would actually know that they probably will have migraine. You have your five phases of your migraine attack. You have your prodrome, and this is not equated to your aura. So aura is another phase. Then you have your headache, your resolution, your recovery, then your back to normal. So you 12 to 24 hours before the headache, your prodrome, you can note irritability, neck pain, food cravings, and in some patients, yawning. Then about 1/2 to 1 hour before the headache, you will have your aura. And then you have your headache phase, which can last for several hours, in which you will have a throbbing headache, nausea, sensitivity to noise, odors, or disability or limited activities, because even mild movement causes headache. And then post-prodrome, 24 hours after the headache, you have a hungover feeling or fatigue or poor concentration. Now, this is what we call your oligemia or your slow march of symptoms typified by migraine. Lashley, the one who described this, actually measured his scotoma to be about 3 millimeters per minute. This is just another imaging study of the oligemia that occurs through the occipital lobe, causing your visual symptoms or visual auras. Now, in terms of migraine diagnosis, you need a detailed history and examination of the patient, and you always look for red flags. So if there are no red flags, then it must be a primary headache. But if it has atypical features, then you might consider a secondary headache, and you might want to do diagnostic testing. Now, you will ask, is this your first or worst headache? Usually, if this is the first, then that would warrant more workup. If this is one of the symptoms you're having now is the same as the ones you've had before. And how did the headache start? Was it gradual or suddenly? And where's the pain? Does the pain spread to any other area? And what kind of pain do you have, whether it's throbbing, stabbing, dull? And important, do you have other medical problems that might predispose you to some other secondary type headaches? Some medicines that you take might actually cause headaches. And if they had any recent dental or medical procedure. These are red. HIV infection or cancer. When on neurologic examination, there are focal neurologic deficits. And we have when you have papilledema edema and when you have headaches subsequent to head trauma. These are red flags that you would need to work out on. What are blue flags? So secondary headaches, but are not life-threatening, not like your red flags. So you can have headache, cervicogenic headache, or cervical spondylosis, headache temporarily linked to whiplash injury, or headache related to reading, or headache clearly temporarily linked to ingestion of medications such as vasodilators, and headaches associated with systemic viral illnesses, although increasingly in this group of patients. In order to simplify this, there's a new, this one called SNOOPS. You look for systemic symptoms. You look for neurological symptoms or normal signs. You note the onset. And if the patient is older, again, as I mentioned, that is a red flag. Whether this is a new or a different headache, and you look for secondary risk factors. Headache location might help. So usually if it's a pain, facial pain due to a temporomandibular junction pain, TMJ dysfunction, then pain is at the temples or in front of the ears, sinuses, those are the typical locations here. If it's cluster, then you have it's clustered around the eye and usually there's tearing and redness of that particular eye. Tension, it's band-like. Migraine, it's usually one-sided with visual changes, as mentioned earlier. And might be due to a problem in the neck, in the top of the head or back of the head. similar to earlier. Now, how do you differentiate migraine and tension type headache? So usually for migraine, it is unilateral. It is usually pulsating, moderate or severe. And more importantly, it is aggravated by routine physical activity. That is why most patients with migraine, they just tend to stay in one place in a dark, quiet area and try not to move. Patients with migraine also have one or the other, photophobia and or phonophobia. With tension type, it is usually bilateral. It is not pulsating, it is usually band-like. And it is not aggravated by routine physical activity. So this is a very good differentiating factor between tension type and migraine headache. So you do have migraine without aura or migraine with aura. In terms of treatment, they would be treated more or less the same. However, even though we do have a diagnostic criteria, 41% of migraine patients would actually report of bilateral pain. And in 50% of the time, when you ask them about their pain, the pain is non-pulsating. So it sometimes confuses the diagnosis. Sometimes you can also, with a history, you can also make a diagnosis of migraine, especially if there's predictable timing around menstruation or ovulation. You have migraine that occurs early ovulation. And if you have your stereotype premonitory symptoms, which we discussed earlier, that can occur 24 hours before the headache, characteristic triggers, which we will discuss. And if the headache abates with sleep, usually migraine patients would tend to sleep it off, and usually when they wake up, they're much better. Kids with similar headaches, they would usually say yes. So in this study in 2003, the strongest predictors of migraine diagnosis is actually nausea, disability, and photophobia. Now, in terms of migraine diagnosis, the EEG is not useful. It is not recommended by the AAN, American Academy of Neurology, but it may be useful if there is alteration or loss of consciousness, residual focal deficits or encephalopathy, or atypical migraineous aura, especially if you're strongly considering that this might actually be a seizure. But in your usual headaches, they're not that useful. So in patients with recurrent migraine, neither you do accept if there is a change in the headache pattern, if the patient has a history of seizures, and there are focal neurologic symptoms or signs. And the MRI usually is more sensitive compared to your CT of the head. Now, so you might want to consider doing a lumbar tap if you have a first unusually severe headache, if you have a thunderclap headache or sudden severe headache with a negative CT head, or if you have a subacute progressive headache, headache associated with fever, confusion, meningism, or seizures, or if you suspect there's a high or low CF pressure suspected. But usually before you do your lumbar tap in this patient, you would do an imaging study first. Now, for acute migraine treatment, you have to have a good relationship with your patient because this will be a long-term relationship because migraine in itself will not have a cure. You want to promote patient education, and you have to establish with your patient a treatment plan. Then you develop a pharmacologic management plan either for acute treatment or for preventive strategies. So part of it exercise, regular meals, stress management, biofeedback, and cognitive behavioral therapy. There are some triggers of migraine, such as diet, irregular food intake, environmental changes, changes in weather, temperature, and stress can trigger migraine. So these are other triggers. They say that certain foods such as cheese, chocolate, alcohol, aspartame, caffeine, nuts, processed meats, smoked fish, avocados, onions, and monosodium glutamate. But what is strange is that chocolate might trigger it, but not cheese. So in essence, if your patient likes to eat cheese and they don't get headache, then you don't stop them from eating cheese. Or if they like chocolate and they don't get headache, then let them eat chocolates. So they just have to note what they're actually eating that might trigger their headaches. Some certain medications, antibiotics, antihypertensives, your vasodilators, oral contraceptives might cause headache. Some environmental triggers would be flashing lights, bright lights, strong odors. So this might be something that they might have to avoid or be aware of. And in terms of lifestyle, emotional stress, sleep disturbances, overexertion, menstruation, menopause, caffeine withdrawal, fasting, or oversleeping might also trigger migraine headaches. So with migraine headache, you can have acute treatment to stop the pain and prevent progression. You can have preemptive treatment, or you can have preventive treatment. So preventive treatment is more or less long terms for several months. Now, one thing I always tell my patients is that whenever you have migraine, do not wait for your symptoms to get worse. Treat it when it's still early, when it's just mildly throbbing. You always have to use the correct dose and formulation, and try to use your symptomatic treatment 2 to 3 days per week. And just acute migraine treatment might be the best approach, meaning you don't do prophylactic therapy if the attacks are infrequent, and if preventive medication creates problems, or if compliance is a problem, because if you have preventive meds, you have to take this on a daily basis. So don't not working. So you treat at least 2 different attacks with the same medication before. If the treatment is ineffective, and if you tried several drugs or formulations, then you have to reconsider the diagnosis. Make sure the patient is treated early in the attack. Make sure that the patient's dose is optimal. You may change the formulation or route. Here, we used to have subcutaneous injections of sumatriptan, but they removed it from the market because apparently Filipinos don't like using needles. You can change the drug and make sure there is no interfering medication or overuse of drugs, and you might add an adjunct to the treatment. You might want to combine triptans and your NSAIDs, for example. So standard endpoints that we would look for is pain relief, pain-free response, recurrence, and return to normal function or activity. These are some drugs that have been proven. This was from Silberstein in 2000. So here you have your triptans and your dihydroergotamines, and here you have some of your NSAIDs and some other non-specific medications. So your triptans, your 5-HT1B1D1F agonists, they provide rapid onset of action. They're usually highly efficacious. Usually patients, 80% of patients with migraine would respond to this drug, and you can actually sometimes use the response as diagnostic as to whether they have migraine or not. So these are possible areas where your triptans might work in treating vasoconstriction, or your trigeminal inhibition, or decreased pain transmission. And these are several formulations, no? Sumatriptan, solmitriptan, naratriptan. Not all of this might be available in all markets. Here, in the Philippines, we do have sumatriptan and we do have zolmitriptan in tablet form. We don't have the nasal spray. Usually for acute migraine treatment, you'd want to use your stratified care. This is an example. If it's mild to moderate, you might want to try a simple analgesic or combination analgesics with caffeine. Although probably acetaminophen is not that effective, even for mild to moderate, you can try it. If it's associated with nausea, vomiting, you can add an antiemetic. And you might want to consider preventive therapy for this group. And if it is severe, then you use your triptans. You might want to use your opioid analgesics, although this has to be used very sparingly because of its potential for abuse. Then you might use corticosteroids or IV valproate. Corticosteroids as one dose are a very short course. Now, the medications we use has been reviewed in 2012. So group one, this is by the AAN, American Academy of Neurology. So group one would have your proven pronounced statistical and clinical benefit. This would include your acetaminophen plus caffeine plus aspirin per orem, your aspirin, butorphanol, your dihydroergotamines, ibuprofen, naproxen, naratriptan. Sumatriptan is also included here along with your zolmitriptan. Then you have your group two, which is moderate statistical and clinical benefit. Your Etolerac, your lidocaine, meperidine, metoclopramide IV, chlorpromazine, IM. Group three, statistically but not proven clinically. It would include your ergotamine per orem, metoclopramide. Group four, ineffective, and group five, clinical and statistical benefits unknown. Although sometimes, if the headache has been severe, I have been on one dose for this particular patient. One interesting about acute treatment for migraine is you do have your CGRP, or your calcitonin gene-related peptide that is related actually with pain. And they found out that this has been actually, in animal studies, it has been good in actually preventing findings that would cause migraine. But for some reason, it was no longer developed as a drug for migraine. When do you need migraine prophylaxis? When there's an unsatisfactory response to acute therapy, when you have two or more attacks per month that interfere with patients' daily routine, or you may have contraindications to acute treatments or adverse effects related to them. And if they use abortive medications more than 2 to 3 times per week, then you might want to consider preventive migraine treatment. Now, when you choose a conventional migraine preventive medicine, you have to consider the patient's comorbid conditions. Does the patient have depression? Then you might want to use amitriptyline. Or patients have hypertension but should not have asthma or depression, you can then use propranolol as your prophylactic medication. If your patient is hypertensive, then you can use your calcium channel blockers. And if your patient has epilepsy, anxiety, or mania, then probably you can use your anti-epileptic drugs. So you can tailor your drugs to what other comorbid conditions or whatever side effects the patients might actually be feeling. So again, these are preventive guidelines, 2012. Level A would include your, level A would be established as effective. So this include your divalproex or sodium valproate, metoprolol, propranolol, timolol, topiramate. And these are the various doses that have been used. Level B is probably effective, should be considered for patients requiring migraine prophylaxis. This would include your amitriptyline, feverfew, this is a herbal type of drug, histamine, ibuprofen, ketoprofen, magnesium, riboflavin, venlafaxine, atenolol. This has changed since 2000 when they first released guidelines for preventive medications. Level C is possibly effective. Now, this is curious. Candesartan has been tried and seems to be effective in migraine prophylaxis, including carbamazepine, clonidine, guanfacine, lisinopril, nebivolol, pindolol. And again, these are the various doses you can use. And level for conflicting or inadequate evidence, insufficient data to support or refute use for migraine prophylaxis. Now, here we have hyperbaric oxygen that's usually used for treating headache, indomethacin for those with paroxysmal hemicrania. So apparently for migraine, they are not useful. Then you have these meds or treatments established as possibly or probably ineffective for migraine prophylaxis and should not be offered or considered. Let's ask acebutolol, clomipramine, tulacepam, lamotrigine, another anti-epileptic drug, oxcarbazepine, telmisartan, or montelukast. Now, you might want to consider behavioral and physical treatments if the patient has a preference for non-pharmacological interventions or if they have poor tolerance for specific pharmacological treatments or if they have medical contraindications for specific pharmacological treatments like they have asthma, so you can't use a beta blocker. Insufficient or no response to pharmacological treatment if they are pregnant or they're planning pregnancy or are nursing and they don't want to take medications during this period of time. And if they have history of long-term frequent or excessive use of analgesic or acute medications that can aggravate headache problems. Or if they have significant stress or deficient stress coping skills. Now, this is by the US Headache Consortium, and they have labeled as grade A, as relaxation training, thermal biofeedback, EMG biofeedback, cognitive behavioral therapy. But of course, this is limited by who can actually give or train these patients with these types of therapy. Then you can have behavioral therapy combined with preventive therapy, propranolol, graded B, probably not too many studies here. Acupuncture, hypnosis, stents, cervical manipulation, occlusal adjustment, and hyperbaric evidence. There's limited evidence. Although, recently, on review of some literature, acupuncture seems to be gaining as a possible treatment for migraine. Also, recently, there is a device called a supraorbital transcutaneous stimulator that is actually now in the market. This is one study that shows that supraorbital transcutaneous stimulation with a device is effective and safe as a preventive therapy for migraine. The therapeutic gain is within the range of those reported for other preventive drug and non-drug anti-migraine treatments. So this is actually available, although it is kind of expensive to use. No? But probably if you can share it, maybe that might help. Okay, so last, this is one of my last slides. Whenever you have migraine, you have to consider that these patients might also have other comorbid conditions that might need treatment or might affect the choice of your drug. So that ends my lecture. Thank you.